సహనావతు సహనౌభునక్తు సహవీర్యం కరవావహై తేజస్వినావధీతమస్తు మా విద్విషావహై. ఓం శాంతి శాంతి శాంతిః. ఓం పూర్ణమదః పూర్ణమిదం పూర్ణాత్ పూర్ణముదచ్యతే పూర్ణస్య పూర్ణమాదాయ పూర్ణమేవావశిష్యతే. ఓం శాంతి శాంతి శాంతిః. ఓం ఆప్యాయంతు మమాంగాని వాక్ ప్రాణశ్చక్షుశ్రోత్రమసౌ బలమింద్రియాణి చ సర్వాణి సర్వం బ్రహ్మ ఉపనిషదం మాహం బ్రహ్మ నిరాకుర్యాం మామా బ్రహ్మ నిరాకరోద్ అనిరాకరణమస్త్వ నిరాకరణం మే అస్తు. తదాత్మని నిరతే యోపనిషత్సు ధర్మాస్తే మయి సంతు తే మయి సంతు. ఓం శాంతి శాంతి శాంతిః. శ్రుతిస్మృతిపురాణానాం ఆలయం కరుణాలయం నమామి భగవత్పాదం శంకరం లోకశంకరం శంకరం శంకరాచార్యం కేశవం బాదరాయణం సూత్రభాష్యకృతౌ వందే భగవంతౌ పునః పునః. ఈశ్వరో గురురాత్మేది న విభాగినే వ్యోమవద్వ్యాప్తదేహాయ దక్షిణామూర్తయే నమః. ఓం ఇత్యేతదక్షరముద్గీతముపాసీత. ఓమితి హ్యుద్గాయతే తస్యోపవ్యాఖ్యానం. తద్ధైతద్బ్రహ్మ ప్రజాపతయే ఉవాచ. ప్రజాపతిర్మనవే మనుఃప్రజాభ్యః ఆచార్యకులాత్ వేదమధీత్య యథా విధానం గురుః కర్మాతిశేషేణ అవిసమావృత్య కుటుంబే శుచౌ దేశే స్వాధ్యాయమధీయానః ధార్మికాన్ విదధత్. ఆత్మని సర్వేంద్రియాణి సంప్రతిష్ఠాప్య అహింసన్ సర్వభూతాని అన్యత్ర తీర్థేభ్యః సఖలు ఏవం వర్తయన్ యావదాయుషం బ్రహ్మలోకం అభిసంపద్యతే నచ పునరావర్తతే నచ పునరావర్తతే ఇది నచ పునరావర్తతే. అభిసమావృత్య సో భాష్యకర ఎక్స్ప్లెయిన్ హౌ గురుః కర్మ అతిశేషేణ the time that remains after guru shushrusha or serving the teacher and that is pradhanya pradarshanartham. It is not that only guru seva is to be done and other things are not to be done. Pradhanya pradarshanartham, it is for showing the predominance or importance of the guru shushrusha or guru seva, the service to the teacher. కర్మశూన్యో యతిశిష్ట కాల तेन कालेन विदमसीत् इत्यर्थः whatever time remains after serving the teacher, in that time one should study the Vedas. एवं ही नियमवता अधीतो वेदः कर्म ज्ञान फल प्राप्तये भवति न अन्यथा इति अभिप्रायः. Thereby this Shruti is telling us that एवं ही नियमवता अधीतो वेदः. Veda that is studied by the one who follows this niyam or the rule or stipulation that Veda alone karma jnana phalapraptaye bhavati, that alone becomes effective in attaining the phalam, the result of karma and jnanam, of ritual and meditations, which is what the Vedas prescribe. They become effective only when it is studied by the student who observes these rules. Na anyatha. It's very clear. If you do not follow the stipulations, then the study the Veda does not become effective. Meaning that study the Veda serves no purpose if it is not studied in this prescribed manner. Abhisamavritya karma jignyasam samapayitva. Having concluded the dharma jignyasa, meaning having studied the shastra jaimini yukta disha puram karma vicharam krutva, puram karma vicharam krutva, thoroughly, completely and thoroughly analyzing the performance of dharma or the duty, karma, the rituals, and everything else that is prescribed. Jaimini yukta disha vicharya sa vicharam krutva. Says Jaimini in his sutras, the Dharma Sutra or Mimamsa Sutra, has in fact done the karma vichara. How to perform various karmas or various rituals. So that is how one has to do. Meaning that one has to learn how to perform the various karma, the rituals prescribed by the Vedas. And that is how one becomes prepared to proceed with one's life. The life of activity. So far was the life of study. Now enters the life of activity, the social life enters. Dharma jignyasam samapaitva gulukulan nivrutya. Returning from leaving the gurukula, returning home from the gurukula. Nyayatah daran ahrutya. Accepting a partner, nyayatah, according to the tradition. Kudumbe sthitva. Remaining in the kutumba or the family, meaning leading the life of a householder. Garasthye vihite karmani tishtan. Kutumbe means kutumbe sthitva. Remaining in the family, which means that performing the duties prescribed for a householder. That's what it means. There also tatravi. Gārhasthya vidhitānām karmanām madhye. There also, like before, while he is devoted to performing his duty as a householder, then also svādhyasya prādhānya pradarsanātam ucchate. Just as while studying the Vedas, the Guru Shushrusha or serving the teacher was the most important thing to do. In fact, study of the Vedas also found a second place after the serving of the teacher. Similarly also, in the life of the householder, the swadhyaya, the study of the Vedas, reciting the Vedas and teaching them, is also the most important. Shuchau vivikte vivikte amedhyaya rahite deshe yathavat asinaha. being seated in a stipulated manner in a place of solitude which is clean and which is pure. Swadhyaya Adhyana, reciting the Vedas, Sunaityakam. So the Nitya Karma or the daily study that is prescribed. Adhikam cha yatha shakti yogade abhyasam cha kurvan. And apart by this, it is said that one should always endeavor to always increase one's base of knowledge. Endeavor, also as the time and energy permit, in studying the new texts also. Dharmikan, putran, shishyamsa, dharmayuktan, vidadhata. And also initiating his children as his sons as well as the disciples into virtuous life. Meaning again the life of brahmacharya, grihastha and performing various duties. So life of dharma, dharmikan vidadhat. Initiating and encouraging and guiding one's progeny as well as one's disciples to live the life of dharma or the virtue. And dharma means the values prescribed by the Vedas. So he initiates also his followers into the same kind of life, reciting the Vedas and passing on that knowledge to their sons and disciples. Thus, one should also conscientiously attempt not only to study and imbibe the teaching in oneself, but should also become a link to passing on this knowledge to the next generation. And that is how the Vedic studies or the Vedic texts are passed on to us for generations, thousands of millennia. Only because of this, it was considered the duty of a householder to continue to study what he did and also become a link in imparting this knowledge to the next generation. Now, we go to page 432. If you look at the line 18, Purvam agrahitasyaapi tayo vridhyartham adhyanam darshayate. So, even though he may not have studied that from his own teacher, he should continue to learn tayo vridhyartham. That swadhyaya and pravachana must be enhanced all the time. Then the Upanishad said, Atmani sarvendhyani sampradishthapya. Atmani is one's own self. Sarvendhyani, all the sense organs. Pradishthapya, focusing, withdrawing all the sense organs within oneself. So that part Bhashyakara explains. In the second line, Atmani sarudaye harde brahmane sarvendriyane sampradishthapya upasamhritya indriya grahanat karmani cha sanyasya. So atmani, within oneself, means swahrudaye, in one's heart. Not only one's heart, but then harde brahmani. Concentrating or meditating upon not only within one's heart, but the harde brahmani. Brahman that manifests itself in the heart, dharakasha. So again that meditating upon the dhara or param brahma that shines as the very self in one's own heart. And for focusing attention totally to oneself, it is naturally necessary to withdraw the attention from everything else. So, sarvendriyani sampradishtapya, establishing all one's sense organs in Brahman, the self, which is shining in the heart. Sarvadvarani sayamya, mano vridhi nirvudhyacha, murdhnya adhyayatmana pranam, asthito yogadharanam, omittiga aksharam brahma, vyaharan mamanasmaran. Although this is the description of the departure from this body, sarvadvarani sayamya, so closing or restraining all the gateways from which the mind can go out, restraining those. Mano, so mind is now not allowed to go out. Mano rudhi nirudhyacha, and the mind is totally restrained within one's own in the heart. Murdhnyadhayat, then the prana also is again focused in the crown of the head. So that's the description there. But here it is primarily focusing one's attention totally into Brahman, into the self that is shining in the heart. Sutta Udeshe Pratishthapya, all of this Lord Krishna also said there. And Kaivalya Upanishad also gives very beautiful instructions about this meditation. Indira Grahanat Karmani Sanyasya. So Bhashyakara says that when it is said that you should fold up all your sense organs, should withdraw all the sense organs from their activities. So that includes both the organs of perception as well as organs of action. All of them are so, meaning that they are now made free from all their natural activities. Yada panchavatishtante jnanani manasasaha buddhischa navicheshtate. So yada pancha jnanani avatishtante. When all the five sense organs of perception, they abide in their own locus, and also the organs of action, manasasa, along with the mind, buddhischa navicheshtati, and buddhi also does not do any activity. Meaning the entire personality is totally quiet and silent and serene. Tam yogavitamanyante sthiram indriyadharanam. Thus this total concentration of sense organs and mind is called yoga. All of this is possible only when the mind is free from all other concerns also. Therefore, indriya-grahanat karmanija sanyasya. As long as there is this moderation of having to perform one's enjoined duties, so long that will always remain a matter of anxiety for the mind as to this has to be done. And in fact, for a householder also, there may be so many duties that may hardly leave any time for meditation. So Bhashyakara thinks that this is not the instruction on meditation at a part time, but this is how one is to do. Having lived the life of a householder then, now next stage is withdrawing attention to oneself into dhara akasha. So, karmani cha sanyasya. So, this is possible only when all the karma, meaning all the duties, are renounced. Duty means something that has to be done. All of that is now given up. For in favor of this is to be done. So, he's doing something all right. Except that he has given up the external activities and now so that he can focus totally toward in himself. So, this is the this is how the Vedic, you know, the tradition is, that ultimately one has to come to oneself. which is where Ishvara is, which is where the Self is. So, Sarvani Dharva Sannyasa. So, Bhashyakara thinks that now what follows applies to a sannyasi. So, Sarvendiyani Atmani, Sarvendiyani Sampratishthapya means this is what a sannyasi can do. The sixth chapter also, Bhagavad Gita, Bhashyakara says, Shucha Udeshe Pratishthapya Sthiramatna Yogi Yunjita Sadadam Atmanam Rahasya Sthitaha Ekagi Yata Chittatma Nirashi Aparigraha. That yogi or the aspirant, Yunjita Sadadam, constantly focus his mind upon the self, upon the object of meditation. Rahasi, in a place of solitude, Ekagi, all by himself. Yata Chittatma, with the body and the mind and sense organs completely under control. Nirashi, with the mind free from all the desires. Aparigraha, which having no possessions at all. So Vasyakara said that these stipulations can only be satisfied by a sannyasi, not by a grihastha. So even though Lord Krishna may not mention sannyasa overtly or, you know, expressly, but the description seems to apply only to sannyasi. Says the Tika on the line 18, Harde Brahmaneti Pratyek Rupena Hrudayam Pravishte Brahmanityartha. Ani Jivena Atmana, as the Upanishad says, that may enter here. Anupravishya Nam Rupe Vyakarvani Ota Sushtva Tadeva Anupravishada. So apparently, Brahman is entered the heart of all living beings. Harde Brahmani di Pratyek Rupena Hrudayam Pravishte Brahmani. See, the description means that, what Upanishad says means that Brahman, which is limitless, which is Jagat Karanam, the very cause of creation, has entered as the very self. And therefore, when it is said that one should withdraw one's attention upon the self, meaning one should meditate upon oneself as Brahman. Sarvendriya upasamharoktya karmendriyana vivasamharat. So, sarvendriyani atmani paristhapan. So, meaning that since all the sense organs must be withdrawn, all the sense organs should also include the karmendriyani organs of action. So, no actions also can be performed by this one. Therefore, sarva karma sannyasena suruvasthana matra vivakshitam. So, what is intended by Upanishad is that sarva karma sannyasena, by renouncing all the duties. So, what is the purpose of renouncing duties? Suruva avasthanam. So that one can totally remain with oneself. Atra vivaksha, that's a vivaksha. That is what is intended to be conveyed here. So, Vashyakara is Sarvendriya Grahanat Sarva Karmani Sanyasya. The Tika says, Tarhi Jivan Hetu Vyavaharasyapi Abhavat. So, you have now renounced all the duties. You are simply withdrawn yourself into your own self, not performing any activities at all. Jivan hetu vyavaharasyabhi. But some minimum activity is required to sustain one's life. So, abhava jivana vilopaha. So, even that minimum activity that is required to sustain one's life, to continue the life of, the, you know, the yatra of this body. If those activities are also given up, like food and water, drink and everything is given up, then jivana vilopasyat, then the life cannot continue anymore. Iti ashankya bhikshatanadikam anujanati. So then this question comes, as to how does he sustain himself. I mean, how does his body continue to live? And so there is no prescription of taking one's life. Meaning that one should, because only way you can gain abidance in self is to continue this practice. And practice of focusing or concentrating on oneself can be continued provided you are around, you know. So this presupposes the person should remain alive. And for remaining alive, the minimum needs of the body also should be provided. And therefore, bhikshatanadikam anujnatamityarthah. So, it is again by asabhakti only you have to say that it follows naturally that he must be living alive, he must be keeping himself alive. And the only way to do is bhikshatan or parigraha. He is no parigraha at all. That he can't do, he doesn't have any the facility to cook. Fire is given up. So he must go out and beg his food. So bhikshatanadikam anujnatamityartha. So Shruti also here permits or gives consent to bhikshatanam for going and, I mean, begging the food. Anyatha sarvendri upasamharavata. No, yeah, okay. Then. Ahimsani Subhashyakara says, Ahimsan Himsam Parapidam Akurvan Sarvabhutani Sthavarjangamani Bhutani Apidayan Ityarthah. So this is now Vrata is giving immunity from fear. So this is also nothing but description of sannyasa. Avayam sarvabhutebhyo dattva sannyasya macharet. One should practice sannyasa by first granting immunity from fear to all the beings. So one of the important vows of a sannyasi is that he is no more a source of fear to anybody. Bhūloka bhūloka maya loka maya tyakta suvar loka maya tyakta. So I have given up bhūloka bhūloka suvar loka. I mean, I have no claim on anything that belongs to this world and the intermediate world and the svarga. And I have no claim. I have given up. Meaning that I make no demands upon anybody in this world or any other world also. What does it mean? It means that whatever comes on its own is all, you know, I don't make any demand. Then whatever comes on its own, that's how I sustain myself. No claim, no demands, no competition, nothing. So I'm not a threat to anybody. So this is the idea is that only with this mindset it is possible to meditate, not otherwise. So ahimsa seems to be a required state of mind for effectively withdrawing your attention to yourself or doing any kind of spiritual thing. Ahimsa is a first requirement. So sannyasi apparently the person is totally dedicated to one spiritual upliftment or abidance in the self. Ahimsa or non-violence is a necessary condition. But only that kind of frame of mind, that when the mind is free from any concern at all, because when I give immunity from fear to everybody, I give freedom to everybody to be what they are. I make no demand upon them as to what they should do, what they should not do. I give them total freedom. Then only my mind becomes free from concern or anxiety about anything. What will other fellow do? No, it's no concern. They have freedom to do what they, because I don't make, once I make a demand, I become an object of fear. when we make demands upon others, then either people are afraid because he is asking for this, or I become an object of resentment. Either I create udvega in them or they create udvega in me. One of the udvega will be there. So himsa brings about udvega. Any kind of demands, expectations, rights, claims will bring about udvega to others and to me also. So see how for a sannyasi, ahimsa is the most important vrata. And Lord Krishna also said, what is ahimsa is that, you know, Atmopamena sarvatra samam pashyati yojana. He treats everybody like he treats himself. That's it. That's the way to follow ahimsa. The freedom that I give to myself is the freedom that I should give to others, or the importance and love I give to myself is what I should give to others. That's the basis of ahimsa. So ahimsa involves love automatically. One cannot follow ahimsa unless there is compassion and love. Otherwise it becomes a dry ahimsa. That is also when that is nothing but isolation, you know, and that I it's not that I indulge into any life, but at the same time, I'm not indifferent to anybody. There is sarva bhuta, my heart is basically devoted to well-being of all. There may not be any activity in terms of reaching out for well-being, but I wish the well-being of all. I wish ill of nobody. All this kind of state of mind is required for effectively meditating, so that the mind remains free from those concerns and anxieties, etc. So ahimsan sarabhutani. Sarabhutani sthavar jangamani bhutani apidayan. So living beings with a sthavara or jangama, immobile or mobile, whatever living beings are. So pida or the pain ultimately comes to living because the inert things don't feel the pain, therefore ahimsa or the non-violence basically is practiced towards living beings. But ahimsa has so many dimensions. Satya also is a dimension of ahimsa. Asteyam, non-staying, also is ahimsa. Brahmacharya, total self-control, also is ahimsa. Aparigraha, not accepting any gift and not keeping. So that means that non-possession also is ahimsa. So Vashyakara says, Bhiksha nimittam atanadinapi parapida syat ityatah ah anyatra tirthebhyah tirtham nama shastranujnya vishayah tatah anyatra ityasaha bhiksha nimittam atana dinapi. So atanam, the moving about, there is required for bhiksha atanam, even for begging your food also to go around. And parapida syat. So even when you are moving about begging your food, then also it's possible that you may cause some himsa. Some small creatures also may perhaps be hurt by you when you're moving about. Or whatever himsa may be caused, when you go around, something or the other will happen. Depends on what your concept of himsa is. So the Jain sadhus also will even have a mask on their face because they don't want to kill the bacteria also. But the thing is, bacteria are small little insects. They do not want to hurt them. So, moment you do some vyavahara, it is possible, likely that violence in even a minute way may take place. And so, Meaning that it is not possible to live a life of non-violence at the total non-violence at the physical level. That's the idea. At the physical level, when you live, some violence is inevitable. Kandani, Peshani, Chulli, Udukumbi, Chamarjani, even for simplest life also. That when you pound something or when you grind something, or when you even, you know, use a stove, wood stove, etc., some himsa will be involved. Even though sannyasi doesn't do that, this is the himsa of the householder. So sannyasi doesn't do any of those activities that doesn't cause himsa. And still, some water will be required. I mean, you have to take bath and you have to go to river to take bath. Something has to be done. And however alert you are, it is still possible that some injury may take place to the creatures. So, ahimsan sarvabhutani, not injuring any living being, is a vrata that is not totally, it cannot be 100% followed at the physical level. At the level of speech, yes, you can be totally non-violent. You should be. The level of mind also, you can be non-violent. You should be. Basically, at the level of mind that we want to be non-violent, because this is where the mind is where we have to meditate. But then that also presupposes freedom from violence at the physical level and the speech level also. So speech and mind are under control of the sadhu or for anybody. But the inevitable kind of injury that may take place by even living the simplest of the lives. So of course, for non-violence, one of the important requirements is that life should become as simple as possible and as non-demanding as possible. And as close to the nature as possible also. But it cannot be 100%, you know. So some violence is likely to occur. That much violence is permitted. So anyat, that's why Vashyakara said, so parapida iti atra anyatra teersebhyaha. Remaining free from violence towards all living beings in the area which is other than teertha. Now what is teertha? Teertha can be interpreted as a holy place, place of pilgrimage. But here Vashyakara is teertham nama shastra anujnya vishayaha. Whatever it is that the shastra or the scripture anujnya has permitted. In this case, bhikshatanam is shastra anujnya vishayaha. Here, bhikshatanam meaning that going out for bhiksha is something that is consented by shastra. So, other than bhikshatanam, no violence should take place. That's what it means. Shastra anujnya vishaya tata anyatra ityartha. It is not in a place other than tirtha. It is any kind of activity other than what is enjoined by the scriptures. For a sannyasi, all that is permitted is bhikshatanam. And so not making sure that you do not involve any injury in any activity other than bhikshatanam. Meaning there is no activity other than bhikshatanam also. Bhikshatanam, of course, living the life, I'm taking bath and stuff like that. So, whatever that in bhikshatanam includes that, we assume. So, this is Vashyakara's. So, bhikshatanadi vyaparat anyatra. So, ti anyatra tirthebhya means what? Bhikshatanadi vyaparat anyatra. What is? So, tirtha is shastra anujnya vishaya, that which is permitted by shastra. What is it? Bhikshatanam. So Tikakara says bhikshatanadi vyaparat anyatra ahimsan. That's what it means. Anyatra tirthabhya means what? Bhikshatanadi vyaparat anyatra ahimsan. Not hurting anybody in anything other than bhikshatanam. So whatever himsa takes place in bhikshatanam also is allowed with nothing else. So this does not refer to, Tirtha does not refer to a place. Tirtha refers to activity. In case of sannyasi, the activity is bhikshatanam. Other than not injuring anything, any creature other than bhikshatanam. Yukti dvara bhikshatanadikam anujnatam ityartha. So Bhashyakara and Shruti also, they give consent to bhikshatanam, going about for begging the food. Anyatha sarvendriyopasamharavadha himsayaha prasakte padisheda anupatte. So why should you have to constrain, or why should you restrict that no himsa should take place other than tirtha? Then if bhikshatanam also is not permitted, meaning that this yati doesn't perform any activity other than meditation, then the question of himsa does not arise. If possibility of himsa does not arise, then restricting also does not arise. Don't injure. But you know, even possibility of injuring, if I'm just sitting in one place and meditating, the possibility of injuring can come only when I'm moving about. So when Upanishad says that do not hurt any creature other than Tirtha, that means that some activity is presupposed, then only himsa or some injury is a part. And that activity can be only bhikshatanam for a sadhu and nothing else. So this is by arthabhatti that we say that this is the, because sarvendriyani atmani sampradishthapya means it is sannyasa. Only sannyasi can do, withdraw all his sense organs and mind into the self. And we take, assume that for him to continue his sadhana, he has to live. Therefore, minimum activity is required for sustaining the body also are permitted. When it says anyat ahimsan sarvabhutani anyat tirsebhya, so possible himsa is there, therefore ahimsan. Anyat tirsebhya, in activities other than what is permitted, meaning in activities, namely bhikshatanam. So these words of Shruti amount to saying that the Shruti permits the activity of bhikshatanam and restricts the himsa only to that and in no other activity. Meaning not undertaking any activity that may involve himsa to any creature other than bhiksha. Himsa aprasakte hai. Otherwise, if you don't do anything, even the question of himsa or injury does not arise, then the question of denying or prohibiting injury also does not arise. The fact that injury is prohibited means that the possible injury, and that can be only when you are moving about for bhikshatanam. Therefore, bhikshatanam by arthapatti arthat, bhikshatanam also is permitted by the Shruti. Now comes the explanation by somebody else. So this is Bhashyakara, which means that according to Bhashyakara, this is a description of a sannyasi. However, the Tikakara says, Tatascha bhikshatanadi vyapare anujnyate tu tatra himsa prasaktim ashankya ahimsanidhyasya na prakrutso ashankya ahimsanidhyasya na prakrutso sarva karma sanyasi matra vishetvam abhidu samarthyat sarvashramitva vishetvam iti aha. So some people interpret saying this one is anyatra tirthebhya. So ahimsanidhi, not injuring anybody. So tirtha can also mean a holy place. Anyatra tirthebhya. You should not, no injury should take place in a place other than tirtha or a holy place. Meaning when you are in tirtha, then perhaps some himsa may take place, but not anywhere else. That's what it means. Or when you are in, or some people say when you are in Tirtha, no Himsa will take place. Elsewhere it is okay, you know. So na prakruta sarvakarma sannyasi matra vishayatvam, that Ahimsan sarvabhutani is not only string, is not restricted near the sannyasi, but then this should apply to all the members of all the stages of life. Abhidu samarthya sarvashrami vishayatvamidhi, that this ahimsa, vrata ahimsa, should be confined not merely to sannyasi, but should also be applicable to all, people of all the stages of life. Brahmachari, grihastha, vanaprastha, nobody should do himsa. Iti aha sarvayate. So, either this may be Bhashyakara's view or it is view of the Purapakshi. This writing is very unclear, but anyway, so let's see the next one. Sarvashraminam cha etat samanam tirthebhyah anyatra ahimsa eva iti. Should not be anyatra ahimsa eva iti. O sarvashraminam cha etat samanam. Let us say that this ahimsa is samanam, equally applies to the members of all the stages of life, meaning it applies to brahmachari, grihastha, vanaprastha also. Tirthebhya anyatra ahimsa eva iti. That only in tirtha himsa may be, in tirtha alone the himsa is permitted. In anything other than tirtha, himsa is not permitted. This applies to all the ashramas. Where tirtha is what? Tirtha is the activities that is consented by the Shruti. So for a householder, that may involve performing yajna yagadi, which definitely involves himsa. That is permitted. So a brahmachari, whatever the scripture wants him to do, whatever activity the brahmachari is supposed to do, if himsa is involved in that activity, that is permitted. No, nothing other than those activities. So, grihastha also is enjoying certain activities which is much more than brahmachari. He is supposed to perform all the mahayajnas, etc. So, if those things involve himsa, then that is permitted. But in nothing other than that. Vanaprastha, sannyasi, etc. For sannyasi, the activity can only be bhikshatanam, so there himsa is permitted. There is no other activity, so there is no himsa permitted elsewhere. If you apply this statement to grihastha, then an activity that grihastha is supposed to perform, which involves yagadi, there also himsa takes place, but that is okay. This is not considered himsa by some people. So mimamsakas do not consider the himsa taking place, including suppose some yagas are there, where the animal is to be sacrificed, it is also not himsa. So this is a mimamsa view. Anyatra tirthebhyah. If tirtha is the shastra anujnata vishaya, so whatever activity shastra has permitted, then what takes place is not called himsa. And therefore, all those things are permitted by the scriptures. But anything else, you must make sure that no himsa or injury is involved. Alright, so sarvashramda itasamanam tirthebhya anyatra ahimsa evaiti. That means this vakya ahimsam sarabhutane applies to people of all stages of life. So Tikakara says, anyatra tirthebhya uchyate ityasya vakyasya arthavatvam iti. Then only anyatra tirthebhya iti uchyate. So sarvashraminam chetasamanam. Tirthivyanyatra himsaya vaiti, then only this statement, anyatra tirthibhya, will have meaning only when this statement of ahimsa applies to all the stages of life. If it is applied only to the sannyasi, maybe anyatra tirthibhya was not need, there is no need to write that. The fact that tirtha means all activities permitted by scriptures, Then scriptures in fact enjoin activities to all people of all states of life, and therefore, perhaps this statement, Ahimsan sarabhutani anyata tirthebhya, not injuring any living being in places or activities other than tirtha, seems that that would be meaningful only when this statement applies to people of all stages of life. But primarily here it applies to only sannyasi. So when it is said sarvendriyane atmani sampradishthapya, is the description applies to sannyasi. Ahimsan sarabhutani sarvatethebhya is a statement applies to all the stages of life. That's how you have to say. Now the continued tika. Evam bhutasya vidushaha sadhya sharira pade prapte. So this kind of vidwan who is now focused all his attention upon the self that is Brahman, meaning one who has become one with Brahman, who has become Brahman, is a vidwan, meaning is a wise person who abides in the knowledge that I am Brahman and everything is Brahman. Sadhya sharira pade prapte. Then somebody may think that for a wise person now, since he is already liberated and he has nothing now to accomplish, therefore there is no reason for his body to continue. So this kind of a conclusion one may arrive at, that now that all his agenda is fulfilled, what is the need for his body to continue? So sadhya sharira pate prapte. This kind of a question can arise in the mind of somebody, that now because this wise person has nothing accomplished, therefore there is no reason why his body should also continue. So as long as he gains abiding and knowledge, right away his body also should drop off. Because what is the purpose of the body? For moksha this body has been acquired. That purpose is served. So now body does not have any purpose to continue. So some people believe that the wise person should drop off, his body should drop off. Idi prapte. So Upanishad says, no, there is something called Jivan Mukti. So there is a view that there is no Jivan Mukti because there is no reason for the wise person to continue. But Upanishad says there is something called the liberated even while living. Therefore, then this statement of Chandogya Upanishad is quoted as Pramana. Tasya tavadeva charamiti shastadhyaya uktaritya. In this Upanishad itself, in the 6th chapter, it is said that tasya tavadeva charam yavanda vimokshe atha sampatshe. This wise person has to wait only that long, as long as body is not vimoksha, I mean, as long as body does not drop off, so long as to remain for full moksha. That means as long as alive, the apparent limitation of the body remains upadhi even for the wise person also. From the standpoint of wise person, there is no limitation. But from the standpoint of others, it may look like the wise person also is limited by his upadhi. That means he does not enjoy unrestricted freedom, moksha. If moksha is unrestricted, unconditional freedom, then even a wise person also does not seem to enjoy that, because he also is restrained or limited by the limitations of upadhi. So even that limitation also will not, he has to stay with that limitation and wait until his body drops off. Then he becomes prime, he becomes one with Sat or Brahman in a total sense. As though the body is a little bit of an obstacle in his attaining full moksha, you know, from standpoint of others. It is shastadhyaya yukta ritya prarabdha karma kshaya pratisham darshayati shruti. Shruti also says that prarabdha karma kshaya pratisham, that wise person also is pratiksha, is also has to wait prarabdha karma kshaya, for kshaya or exhaustion of his prarabdha karma. Until then, the wise person also has to wait. This Shruti also says that. It was said in the 6th chapter, and here also what is said can be interpreted that way. So, Sakhalu. So, if you go back to the passages, then Sakhalu evam vartayan yavad ayusham. Looking at the text itself, Sakhalu evam vartayan yavad ayusham. Meaning that conducting himself in this manner as long as he is alive. Conducting what? That his mind is absorbed in the self that is Brahman. As long as alive, this is how he lives for the rest of the life. Brahma lokam avisampadyate yavad ayusham. When the ayusha of the life is over, Brahma lokam avisampadyate. He attains Brahma loka. Nacha punaravartate. He does not return. Nacha punaravarte, he does not return. So, if you look at this description, again it is description of the person who has withdrawn all his sense organs into the self. And therefore, who is a sannyasi? Therefore, who is a wise person? Then the wise person also, even yavad ayusham, as long as alive, this is how he lives. So, a jivan mukta need not always be in samadhi by way of state of mind. He is always in samadhi even while doing activity because his mind abides in the self. Because self is self-effulgent. So, ayavad ayusham, when the ayusha is over, brahma lokam avisampadyate, he attains brahma loka. What is the nature of attainment of brahma loka? So, attaining brahma loka also can be two ways. So, what is the manner of his attaining Brahma Loka? Nacha punaravartade, nacha punaravartade iti. That he does not return, he does not return. Yad gatva na nivartande, tad dhama paramam mama. So, that is my swarupa attaining which there is no return. Tatah padam tat parimargitabhyam, yasmin gatana nivartanti bhuyaha. Yasmin gataha bhuyanna nivartanti. Having reached what? They do not return again. So, this is a description of the videha muktaha. Jivan muktaha and videha muktaha. So, this is how this passage is interpreted. By Bhashyakara, supposedly. So, by this Tikakara anyway. So, if you go back to Tika. So, prarabdha karma kshaya pratiksham darshayati shruti hi sakhalu evameti. So, when Shruti says sakhalu evam vartayan yavad ayusham, it is that he waits for the prarabdha kshaya and then brahma lokam abhisampadyate, then he attains brahma loka. So, Tika says brahma eva loka brahma loka. Brahma itself is loka. Now, loka word normally means a realm. The rudi, the common meaning of the word loka is what? A realm, such as heaven, brahma loka, etc. So, when we use the word brahma loka, generally the first impression that comes is, it is the realm of Brahma. So, no, the word loka is not realm. Loka lokanam prakashayati. So, lok bhashayam deeptau cha. So, one of the meaning of the word, the root lok is deeptau, is also in sense of prakasha. So, the loka is lokanam, means shining. So, prakasha, the light, which is what? Consciousness. So, prakasham brahma ityartha. So, word loka here means prakasha, the light, or knowledge, or consciousness, which means Brahman. The self-effulgent Brahman is the meaning of loka in this context. So, Brahma eva loka. Brahma alone is loka, that is consciousness, which is self-effulgent, which is self. So, so prakasha Brahma abhisampadyate. He becomes one with Brahman, that is the self-effulgent. That's what the statement means. Evam bhutasya avidyanashad. Bija abhavena na punarvutti diyaha. Evam bhutasya. For a wise person of this nature, avidyanashat, because the ignorance is dispelled, bija abhavena, Ignorance is a seed for punaravarti, for returning into this life of birth and death. So ignorance brings about the ahankara, mamakara, etc. And they are the causes for taking the new birth. The bijam is not there. The very seed, the very cause for the samsara of the nature of the repeated birth and death is ignorance. And that itself is dispelled. Never, na punaravartihi. The cause for punaravarti, the cause for rebirth itself is gone. Therefore, the rebirth with effect also does not take place. So, Shrutihi, nasa punaravartate, nasa punaravartate, he does not return. Like all other Shrutis also say. And so, what is it? So, Brahma yavasanna, Brahma apyedi. He attains Brahma, because already is Brahma. Tasya prana na utkramanti. Yeva samavaniyante. His pranas now do not depart. They merge in Brahman here itself. By saying that, there is no utkramanam. If there is a departure of this body, then that means there is attainment of another body. Utkramanam. If in fact this, the Jivatma lives here, then he goes someplace. Either goes to Brahmaloka, of course, or goes to some other body. But then, still some yatra is involved. So there Upanishad says, for a Jivan Mukta, even this is also not there, his pranas, they merge into Brahman here itself. Meaning that there is no utkramana. There is no, this is what he said. There is no departure from this body. That says it's gone. Therefore, but anyway, so nasa punaravartate. Utkramana is there, means attaining something is there. If you attain Brahmaloka, then likely you can come back. Because you go someplace, then you have to come back also. So, evam swabhimatam vyakhyanam darshayitva. So this is swabhimatam. This is Bhashyakara's mata. According to this Tikakara. That Bhashyakara looks upon this description in the Shruti as that of a Jivan Mukta. And nasa punaravartate is a so brahmalokam abhisampadyate nasa punaravartate is a description of the Videha Mukta. And that means that this Upanishad concludes with the discussion or description of a wise person, of a sannyasi. So, this is one interpretation. Then other interpretation is that, no, this is description not of a sannyasi, but of a householder. And therefore, evam svabhimatam vyakhyanam darshayitva. This vyakhyanam, the exposition or explanation of this passage, svabhimatam, according to one's own mata or vashyakara. Ke kaischittu. But vashyakara also here apparently describes the mata or the view of other people. Who are the other people? Puroktanam karmanam vayarthi ashankayam. What's the reason why this passage described all the karma? Acharya kulat vedamatitya yathavidhanam guru karmatisheshana avisamavrutya kutumbe suchavudeshe swadhyayam adhiyanah dharmikan vidadhat. So all these karmas are described. They have no purpose to serve. If this is ultimately description of a sannyasi who has renounced all the karmas and thereby becomes liberated, then what? So that means this karma that are described here, they don't give rise to any fruit or any results. So says, Puruktanam karmanam vayarthi ashankayam. If this Upanishad wanted to conclude with the description of a sannyasi, why should it have described all this karma? They describe brahmacharya ashrama and grihastha ashrama and vanaprastha also as far as meditation is concerned. And then attaining brahmaloka. So looks like this is a description of a householder and not the description of sannyasi. If Shruti intended to conclude with the sannyasi, then there was no need to describe all this karma. That means this passage refers to someone who is still performing his duties, in whichever stage of life that person is. Otherwise, karmanam vaiyarthyashankayam, puroktanam karmanam, all the karmas that are stated vaiyartha, they seem to be meaningless or seem to be redundant, of no use, then that cannot be. Shruti cannot go to the length of describing all this karma, you know. So Acharya Kula, Dveda Maditya, all of that must have some reason. Therefore, to give it the meaningfulness, to give meaningfulness to the description of karma, we have to conclude that this is a description of a householder and not that of a sannyasi. So, Ashankayam, Nirvisande, Karmana, Brahmaloka, Phalakatvena, Vaiyartham Parihriyate. So somebody may think that this karma that I describe have no role to play, no nothing to contribute. He says, no, if this karma that I describe for a householder also, nirvisande, if all those karmas are also performed without abhisandhi, without the expectation or agenda of a karma phala, then brahmaloka phalakatvena, then that karma will result into brahmaloka. That's what Shruti wants to say. That grihastha also, if he lives a life of selflessness and performing his duties, then that can lead him to brahmaloka. So vaiyartham parihriyate, that this description of brahmalokam avisampadyate nasa punaravartate, that description is meant for a householder to say that all his duties performed without the phalabhisandhi or expectation of the result will lead him to brahmaloka, and that way there is the safalyam, also the success or the purposefulness of all the karmas. So when karmas are described, then the purpose achieved by karma also should be described. Therefore, attainment of brahmaloka is the result of performing those karmas selflessly. This is their opinion. So therefore, this description of parihara, vayartya parihara, that somebody may think that the karmas described here would become meaningless if they do not yield any result. If this is only for sannyasi, then what's the use of those karmas? So no, those karmas also yield the result of brahmaloka. Acharya Kulat Ityadika Shrutya Adi Vakyadam. So this Shruti, Acharya Kulat, Vedam Aditya, all of this, Yatha Vidhanam. So all that Shruti is for making clear that the karmas of a householder also, if they are performed as stipulated by the scriptures and performed without selflessly, then he also can attain brahmaloka. These karmas are also meaningful. Don't think that jnana alone is meaningful in the Veda. That karma also is meaningful. So Vedantin will say karma is only secondary. For Vedantin, karma has only result in terms of becoming, giving preparation for jnanam. This is no, karma independently is meaningful by giving you liberation. You attain brahmaloka and then you do not return from brahmaloka. That means what uttarayana means, then so ekaya avartate anyaya avartate punah. Lord Krishna also says that. So there are these two gatis are there, uttarayana and dakshinayana. If you travel along dakshinayana, then you return. Uttarayana, don't return. So this is the description of a householder. Of course, householder of a very high order who also attains the moksha of not returning to this life here. Iti vyakhyatam tadaha. This is what other people think, how they interpret this whole passage. There is also Vashyakara anyeti. So Vashyakara says, anye varnayante. குடும்பே ஏவ ஏதத் சர்வம் குர்வன் சகலு அதிக்ருதஹ யாவதாயுஷம் யாவத் ஜீவம் ஏவம் யதோக்தேன ப்ரகாரேணைவ வர்த்தயன் ப்ரஹ்மலோகம் அவிசம்பத்யதே தேஹாந்தே நச்ச புனராவர்த்ததே ஷரீரக்ரஹணாய இதி அன்யே வர்ணயந்தி. So this is how other people say this passage should be understood. That kutumbe, that remaining in kutumba, not sannyasa, not going to forest, remaining in the family, means in the house, being householder, idha saram kurvan, doing all of this. Was it as a swadhyam, so shushaudeshe, swadhyam adhyana, etc., you know, and so dharmikam vidathat, and sarvendriyani sampradishtha, atmani sampradishthapya, doing all of this for the whole of his life. அதிகிருத்தா. So one who is qualified to do all of this, யாவதாயுஷம் ஏதசரம் குருவன், doing all of this as long as he is alive. Meaning what? யாவஜீவம் ஏவம் யதோக்தேன பிரகாரண வர்த்தயன். So conducting himself in this prescribed manner as long as he is alive. So Anandagiri says, Anandagiri seems to have that opinion also. ஏதத் சர்வம் ஸ்வயம் குர்வன் பிரம்மலோகம் அபிசம்பதேதி சம்பந்த. ஏதத் சர்வம் ஸ்வயம் குர்வன், டூயிங் ஆல் ஆஃப் திஸ், பிரம்மலோகம் அபிசம்பத்யதே, ஹி அட்டைன் பிரம்மலோக இது சம்பந்த. ஏவம் வர்தனி தஸ்ய வியாக்கியானம் ஏவம் யதோக்தேன பிரகாரண குரும் இது. ஸோ சேஸ் ஏவம் வர்த்தயன், உபநிஷத் சேஸ் ஏவம் யாவதாயுஷம் ஏவம் வர்த்தயன், conducting himself in this manner for the rest of his life. That evam vartayan, that the expression is explained as yathoktena prakarena kurvan. Evam means in this manner. Which manner? Yathoktena prakarena. As a manner in which it is described in this passage, living the life, and nobody can do this. I mean, this is not an easy thing to do, but in case somebody can do. Brahmaloka is not here and there that you can walk to Brahmaloka. It's not in Thaltej, Brahma, you know. So Brahmaloka is nothing, you know. So living this life of as stipulated by Veda is impossible for anybody. It's essentially impossible. The kind of duties told by for Grihastha or Vanaprastha, if you see the description, you know, you'll get heart attack. You know, that you can follow those stipulations. But in case you do, maybe there were people who could do that at that time. Because life was simple. And there's no other pressures. No great ambitions, no great opportunities anyway. Other than you're living in a village and your life is of an agrarian. So, whether you're a Vaishya, Shudra, whatever you are, you live your life in a simple life. No competition, no ambitions. So basically, and the mind can be free from all this clutter. This, you know, after all, growing up where we do, naturally, mind will be cluttered by what is going around you. All the time, noise of this election and this and that is going on, your mind will be cluttered. These thoughts will come in your mind also. Then you read newspapers and watch TV, and so all of this is going to clutter the mind when this is not there. Meaning that there are so many things other than you which are also responsible for cluttering your mind. When those things are not there, as our song used to say, nobody knew what happened 10 miles away. You know, nobody knew because there was no communication. So that kept the life simple. With that life, all these things are prescribed. You know, so what the Vedas prescribe, all of that is basically applicable to person who is living that kind of, not this life. Vedas will have heart attack when they see this life. They will, you know, meaning that the new smritis will have to be really now evolved to guide a person in living in this life. How to live spiritual life in these circumstances, for that new smritis are required. With all debates going on right now, the freedom of privacy and freedom, individual freedom, meaning that liberty, freedom is a license. Their interpretation of freedom is like, do whatever you want, it's your life. And therefore, so if this is the interpretation, then spiritual life has no scope at all. As described, if this is called spiritual life, it has no scope at all. This is all useless according to them. This is all restraining yourself and suppressing your feelings, and there's no good. This kind of restraint and suppression is no good. So if this is the atmosphere, then there's some new smritis are required. But all of this was possible for the kind of simple life that existed at that time. And therefore, yavat jivam evam vartayan evam prakaya yathoktena prakayana vartayan, conducting himself in that manner as long as he is alive, brahmalokam avisampadyate. He attains brahmaloka when dehante. Because brahmaloka then means brahmaloka of Brahma. So if this is a description of a householder who attains brahmaloka, then that brahmaloka has to mean the world of Brahma. Because brahmaloka means Brahma itself is loka, that attainment is possible only by knowledge of recognizing yourself as Brahman. But if this is meditation, then that knowledge of identity is not there. There is a identification with Brahman by meditation. And therefore, it is brahmaloka means there is an involved, there is a gati involved here. There is a passage involved from here along the northern solstice. So northern passage is involved. And there was dehante. So there attainment of Brahman is brahmaloka, is saguna brahma. And dehante, after the fall of this body. Nasya punaravartate sharira grahanaya. From that brahmaloka, he does not return for assuming another body. So this is a description of a householder. That is the interpretation of other people. We'll continue tomorrow. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Shankaram Shankaracharyam Keshavam Badarayanam Sutra Bhashya Krutau Vande Bhagavantau Punah Punah. Murti Bheda Vibhagine Vyoma Vadvyapta Dehaya Dakshina Murtaye Namaha. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Hari Om.